Let me start by introducing all of our panelists. First of all, sitting next to me here, we have Conor Friedersdorf, who's a staff writer for The Atlantic. He focuses mainly on politics and national affairs. I can say that personally, I read just about everything that Conor writes on the topics of American criminal justice and also surveillance and government policies related to surveillance. I think he writes really interesting pieces in that area. He's a founding editor of The Best of Journalism, which is a newsletter devoted to exceptional nonfiction. He holds a Bachelor of Arts degree from Pomona College and a Master's in Journalism from NYU. I will also note that I first became acquainted with Conor because I watch his regular program on Blogging Heads TV. So go to bloggingheads.com, I suppose, is the site. It's very thoughtful, interesting conversations with lots of great people. Highly commend it to everybody. Next today, we have Scott Henson, who is the executive director of the Innocence Project of Texas. Scott is also a former journalist. Oh, Innocence Project. He's also a former journalist and a professional political opposition researcher. Henson has worked with various organizations promoting criminal justice reform in Texas for 20 years. Since 2004, he has authored a widely read blog at gritsforbreakfast.org, which covers Texas criminal justice policy and politics. I will tell you that if you have never been to Grits for Breakfast, it is the best criminal justice blog in America that you've never heard of. It is outstanding.
Thank you.
And finally, we've got Reihan Salam, who is executive editor of National Review. He's a columnist at Slate. He's a contributing editor of National Affairs. He is a regular interviewer at Vice.com. There's a lot of affiliations. He also, along with Ross Douthat, the columnist for the New York Times, is the co-author of a book called Grand New Party, How Conservatives Can Win the Working Class and Save the American Dream. Reihan Salam. Well, I had a structure in which I wanted to do these questions, but before walking in tonight, Scott buttonholed me and we had a really fascinating conversation, and I said, I'm gonna make that question number one, and I still wanna do that. So Scott, we were out in the hallway and you had a critique of the structure of news articles and the way articles, not even in criminal justice, but in America, are written these days. I want you to explain that critique to the audience. I think it's fascinating.
Well, pretty loud. Not all news articles per se, but what we were talking about was the use of the anecdotal lead in news articles. There was a New York Times piece by their ombudsman not long ago called The Stranger in the Story that critiqued this, but in criminal justice, it's even a bigger issue than he was describing. When I was first coming up in journalism in the late 80s, we were taught basically what was called the reverse pyramid method of writing your stories. You start with like your main point and you get to the second most important point and you go on down. Your anecdotes are sort of examples that fill out your story, but you don't start with your anecdotes. And part of the reason for that was that, of course, you're writing in paper, and so they actually wanted to be able to physically cut from the bottom. They wanted the most important thing at the top. And if they had to cut, they wanted to, you know, the anecdote might not be as important, but you want the main gist of it to have gotten there. So that was the idea. And then in the late 80s, the Wall Street Journal, and so the journalists of a certain age will remember this, they began to have, starting once a week, on the left-hand column, they would have this, it was astonishing from a journalistic standpoint at the time, they would have these major investigative stories where the first column was just on the front page was all anecdote. It was one person who you'd never heard of, and they would tell their story, and you really wouldn't find out often what the story was about until you like hit the jump and went to the next page. But the story drew you in, and this was a big deal in journalism. There was lots of critique in the journalistic community of like, wow, this is so powerful, it's so moving, and it is, because stories are moving. It's one of the reasons that fiction often can tell more truth than nonfiction, because telling stories is powerful and we can reach truth through stories. But in this context, it makes journalism easy to manipulate. So for example, during the sort of height of the tough on crime era, you would see this model of journalism where the victims' rights groups would come up with some heinous story and promote it through all the media outlets, And then the next thing you know, you have a new law that's promoting tougher penalties that's named after whoever the person was that was sort of your lead anecdote. So you have all these laws, there's sex offender laws, all of them are sort of named after somebody.
Hate's law, this kind of
thing. All of them. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, that has been very problematic. Now, the flip side of that is that, of course, I work in advocacy. I haven't been a journalist for many, many years. And we learn to do effectively the same thing. I work for the Innocence Project of Texas. When our exonerees get out, we tell their stories. We use their stories to try and advocate for change. And some we've passed some very good laws in Texas that way. But I will tell you this. Just because we pass some good laws with that method doesn't mean that journalism is doing anyone any favors. What it means is that the advocates can manipulate journalism as easily on one side as the other. And it means that the journalist is really not doing a good job either way of vetting the issues and making sure that really a broader critique, you know, outside of this one person's myopic view is getting across to the readers. And so, you know, I'm happy to work in that environment as an advocate because, you know, we have tools that'll work and we can play that game too. But from a journalistic perspective, it's actually allowing yourself to be manipulated in many ways, and it's problematic.
You know, Reihan, you do really interesting writing. Conor, you do this kind of thing too, where you are doing reporting, but you're also doing kind of a policy wonk function also. And I wonder, how do you write your articles? Do you try to lead with some kind of a story? And is that poisonous for the larger public policy arguments that people are trying to make?
Well, first, let me just say that I'm really delighted by what you've just said, Scott, because I think that I think this is a very pervasive factor, and you can see why, because you know it's very hard for people to understand large amorphous subjects. Now, I will say that in my own writing, the reporting that I do tends not to be of this kind of narrative style. So it's reporting for my own purposes to kind of get behind, let's say, something that's pretty arid, like a statistical finding or whatever else. But it tends not to get into my writing as such. My writing is much more argument-driven, for better or for worse. And frankly, that makes it less entertaining, you know, to some degree. But I think that, I guess the way that I think about this is that I really believe there are trade-offs in policy. And I think that in a way, I guess the kind of advocacy that I engage in my work, and I'm an opinion journalist, I really try to honor those trade-offs, and I try to make it very clear that the policy prescription I'm advocating actually does indeed probably have some downsides. And let me give you this larger story. Let me present both those things. And partly that's because I want more credibility. And I think that by doing that, by presenting those trade-offs in an upfront way, I think that I can win some credibility and perhaps nudge people in my direction. But there's also a sincere element to it, which is that, you know, I'm trying to make sense of these things. And I'm doing it in a way in which I'm revising my understanding of these issues over time. So by honoring the complexity of these issues, I think that I'm doing some good for readers who are a certain kind of reader who's engaged. But if you're talking about, you know, most people, let's say, are not passionately engaged by the subject of criminal justice reform. It is something that is, let's say, number 7 or 8 on their priority list. You know, it might become more of a priority if it's something that is directly impacting their neighborhood, their community. It might be a higher priority if they hear a spectacular story of some kind. And I think that, you know, that's why advocates are drawn to this, you know, style that you're describing. And I think that, you know, it is very different from what I do, but I also feel as though I'm speaking to a somewhat narrower audience. And so I have the luxury of doing that.
Who is your audience? How would you define your audience?
I guess I think of it as being three different audiences. There is one audience that is people that consists of people who, generally speaking, share my priors, share my gut instincts, but are looking for, you know, information, arguments that basically reinforce what they already think. There's another group of people who want to be upset or outraged by the things that I have to say, and they're reading it for a kind of perverse entertainment. Yeah. That's a kind of smaller group, but that's one group of people too that you encounter. And then there's another group of people who think of themselves as broadly open-minded, do not share my priors or whatever else, but think that, hey, I'm a smarter person by virtue of being exposed to different arguments. And I feel that last category to me is particularly important because, you know, to some degree, those are some people where if they at least accept that you're not an imbecile, which may or may not be right, by the way. But if they accept that, then they might be persuadable on this or that issue. And so, you know, I spent a lot of time kind of crafting arguments for that third audience, although that first audience is also pretty important.
You know, Conor, I want to ask you the same question about who you think your audience is. And more particularly, I wonder if you ever write explicitly for policymakers. And I'm asking you because you live in California. Mm-hmm. And California has been a really fascinating state for criminal justice over the last few years. There was a major Supreme Court decision about the prison releases. Then there was how California had to adjust to that problem. There was California trying to rethink its three strikes law. There have been proposals to tackle things like police abuse. And so, in a sense, I wonder if you're ever writing and thinking, okay, I want some legislator to see this.
I'm not particularly. I do hope that some of my pieces are seen by legislators. You know, I'm writing for a national publication, and so I'm often seeing stories of local interest where I almost think, oh, I wish just for a minute I was working at this local newspaper because this is a really important story and yeah. No one is writing it right now. I got my start at a local newspaper in California, and I check in on my old beat every once in a while.
Which paper?
The Inland Valley Daily Bulletin. I covered Rancho Cucamonga, California. Ah. Lots of exciting things go on there. And so it's, criminal justice issues are tough in some ways to cover at a national publication. Lots of the people who have been the most successful have kind of worked their way up the ranks in journalism to work for places with national audiences. In some ways, that hollows out the newspapers that they all left behind, and so there's a little bit less oversight when it's always 22 and 23-year-olds getting their first jobs, and they're the ones that are put on the police beat. It's pretty hard to have the kind of scrutiny that you need of a police department where you kind of know, you know, I would sit in the city council meetings and look at the agenda items very closely and think, wait, where's all that money going? Oh, mm-hmm. They bought some fancy technology that maybe has some civil liberties implications, right? Mm-hmm. And the death of newspapers, the slow death of newspapers, has led to an increase in corruption, I think, at the local level that isn't seen. There's less of a watchdog role, and that certainly applies to the kind of criminal justice journalism that's really important. It's just disappearing in a lot of places.
Scott, how is the death of newspapers affecting criminal justice coverage and criminal justice journalism?
Oh, man. Well, I mean, you know, I may have critiques of newspapers, but we desperately need them. I mean, it's a big problem that even the policymakers don't really have sources for information. I mean, the reporters, like you say, they're 22, 23 years old, the people mostly covering crime in most, certainly Texas newspapers. And as soon as anybody gets, I have a friend right now who left the San Antonio Express News because she had started out in the crime beat, and they said, well, we want to move you to this other area. She says, no, this is actually what I want to do. Well, no, we're going to move you out. We're going to have another, you know, person straight out of the Daily Texan at UT Austin who's going to take your spot. And so she said, well, you know, I'm going to go to graduate school. I think I'm not going to get to do what I want to do. I'm going to go do something else.
Yeah.
And, you know, one of the main functions of my blog, quite honestly, in Texas, is that we do have such spotty coverage of these topics, is that when the reporters write something, I look at it and say, okay, what are the four things that they didn't know to say or didn't have any information about, and I add those and post it, and that's what it is. I'm sort of filling a lot of the gaps that folks who don't have sort of the same level of experience or sort of knowledge of the data sources, you know, just don't bring to the table with their day-to-day reporting.
There are two other elements at play that are really important. One is the quick turnaround that a lot of daily newspaper reporters on the crime beat are accustomed to working on. And so they have to turn around one or even two stories for the next day's newspaper. Yeah. And that lends itself to calling the watch commander and saying, what happened tonight? And then the watch commander tells you, and then you write that down. There's also an intimidation factor. If you're young, it's your first beat. If you write certain things about police, you're going to have a very powerful local union that probably dines with your publisher every so often, right? That can call you up and harangue you. I've known a lot of reporters who have been harangued and intimidated and yelled at by police sources, usually unions, and I've never heard of the head of the local public defender's office calling up a reporter and saying, hey, this is unfair to our side. It may happen every once in a while, but certainly every reporter knows where they're probably going to get pushback from, and I think that influences coverage.
That's rare. Well, there's a few more questions I want to ask on this front, but there are other broad issues I want to get to, so maybe we'll turn back to this towards Q&A. I want to turn a little bit now to kind of the way, I guess maybe more on who your audience is, but also a bit towards how editorial positions are crafted. And Reihan, I'm really curious about National Review, and I want to ask you, National Review is based out of New York, and New York was kind of, you know, ground zero for the criminal justice, or excuse me, for the crime epidemic story for many decades in the United States, right? I mean, these kinds of iconic stories from the 1980s, things like Bernie Goetz, movies like Serpico, I guess, or, you know, New York stories. I mean, this notion that just crime in the United States is out of control. Like people, when I was growing up, like New York was considered so dangerous. My grandfather's brother lived in New York and he was mugged 5 times in the 1980s. And I can only assume that that must have influenced the way National Review thought about and wrote about crime during that period. But now, New York is the safest big city, arguably, on the planet, not just in America. Has that caused you to change the
Tokyo is much safer.
What's that?
I mean, you know, I would definitely not go that far, but yeah.
not the safest big city. It's not safer than Cairo and some of these other...
That I'm sure is true, but yeah. I mean, I think that it also depends on... But if you're comparing us to Tokyo, to Seoul,
well,
if you're comparing
fair.
Us
yeah,
to...
Sure.
And also, you know, when you're looking at European cities, it's also, there's the homicide risk versus the risk of assault and kind of... So, I mean, I think that, you know...
You do have to be careful, yeah.
Yeah.
Sure. Well, but the broader question, though, is how has this changed National Review's perspective on crime, or has it at all?
So our founder, William F. Buckley Jr., ran for mayor of New York City in the late 1960s, mm-hmm. And much of the reason his campaign wound up really resonating with a lot of people, including surprising people, is because he was talking about the crime epidemic right as it was beginning. So this, you're absolutely right to say that this was a real central concern of the magazine and of the national conservative movement more broadly. I will say that, you know, so in New York City, I guess, you know, the Franklin Zimmering story is that New York City and Los Angeles are distinct because, you know, in across the country, you had one 10-year crime decline in major U.S. cities. Whereas in New York and Los Angeles, you had a second 10-year crime decline that was actually as steep as the first 10-year crime decline. In many other places, it kind of flattened out. But, you know, New York was very unusual in that respect. So, subjectively, I imagine that did have some effect on our editors who are in New York. But also, of course, you know, it faded away as a kind of pressing national political issue. And then, like a lot of people on the political right, a lot of conservatives and libertarians, I think that there was a renewed interest in issues like overcriminalization and other issues that we've discussed here. And also, a National Review was a little unusual in that in the mid-1990s, our founder, William F. Buckley Jr., also came out in favor of the legalization of a wide range of drugs, of recreational drugs, and actually not just cannabis, but he went quite a bit further.
There's a clip, by the way, people should look this up on Firing Line, of William F. Buckley versus Charlie Rangel. And William F. Buckley is arguing for drug legalization, and Charlie Rangel is arguing for getting tougher. It's extraordinary.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think that, and people forget that, there are kind of lots of narratives we have about, you know, kind of the rise of more punitive criminal justice policies, but actually there's a broad coalition of people who favor them, it's important to remember that. But I think that, you know, for Buckley, I mean, it was this kind of broader inquiry, and also it reflected his libertarian impulses, and I'd say that those impulses are not universally shared at the magazine. There are some people who felt that a kind of more punitive approach made sense. But, you know, he definitely set the tone in that regard, and he kind of opened up a conversation. And I'd say more recently, we've become more interested in, you know, I guess the kind of human consequences, the consequences for the workforce, and also just the consequences for the legitimacy of our criminal justice system when it's perceived as being broadly unfair. So I think that, you know, our perspective on the issue has evolved.
Scott, does Grits for Breakfast have an editorial stance in some sense? I've never asked you that. I wonder what
editorial stance?
Yeah, is there a broad editorial position on criminal justice that you try to reflect through Grits for Breakfast?
Oh, no, man. I pull it out of my rear end every morning. What can I tell you? Now, I grits for me is actually very different from what these two fellows are describing. These fellows are actually writing for an audience. And grits is actually not for an audience in quite the same way. I know because I actually write it and publish it, and it's out in the public, and so people read it. And when someone reads something, they think, oh, this is for me to read. And so it's for them. But the way I look at the blog is much different. I use it for basically two or three things that are sort of functions of my own work. So, for example, when I see a newspaper article that I think, oh, gosh, you know, when the legislative session comes next time, I'm going to need that piece of information. I'll pull the money quote. I'll put a citation that's enough so I could footnote it later if I need it in testimony or something like that. Put a few sentences saying why I think it's important. And publish it, and that may be a blog post. Well, that's not necessarily for y'all to know anything. Y'all can subscribe to the newspaper. It's so I'll have that money quote when I need it in a year and a half, you know, when the legislature comes. And similarly, sometimes when I'm doing something that's more, or I'll write up my notes, for example. I'll take, notes at some, you know, event or public hearing or this or that, and I go home and I type them up and I publish them on the blog, and that way I don't have to like keep the paper. I just have my, it's on the blog. And you know, I used to have 5 4-drawer filing cabinets in my office, and every morning I would get up and I would have 5 newspapers come in my driveway. This is, you know, back in the 90s before everything was online. And I'd clip out the articles I cared about and paste them on a piece of paper and write a few sentences why I thought it was important and put it in the filing cabinet. Well, I basically don't do anything different now. I just put it online and open source it, assuming that if it's important to me, if I'm working on these issues, other people who are working on these issues will also find it important, find it useful. Maybe somebody else who I don't know or I'm not thinking about will be able to use it for the same purposes that I'm using it, hopefully. And I find that just sort of letting others into my work in that way adds value for me and for them. But I don't think of it in terms of, you know, writing for my audience. I really very rarely am writing for an audience unless I'm writing something that's more editorial and, say, you know, advocating for a specific policy. And then that's, to me, a sort of different type of scenario where I treat it like, say, a letter to the editor or a constituent letter to someone. But again, instead of a constituent letter to the mayor or to the legislative committee, I'll post it on the blog and then send those same people the link, whoever I would have sent it to. I'll send them the link so I know they see it. But they also know that there's going to be 1,900 opinion leaders who get that link in their email the next morning. Mm. And so it adds a little clout to the to that communication. But again, it's all, the blog is really, you know, very specifically about my own work, and I just sort of allow others to view it as opposed to like it being for them.
Well, I'm going to shift really abruptly again, but it's because I've had so many things I want to talk about. I want to make sure that we cover these broad areas. Conor, I want to direct this question to you. We did an event, one of our attendees here is from Lindenwood University. We had this event at Lindenwood University in St. Charles, Missouri on Monday nights, not too far from Ferguson. And we haven't talked a lot about Ferguson at this this conference, but you know, you've written a lot about what happened in Ferguson last year. You've had a lot of conversations with great people on Blogging Heads about it. What I wanted to ask you is, this DOJ report came out that seemed to really undermine so many things that people thought they learned about what happened in Ferguson, Missouri. Just as a small example, it seems very clear, according to this Department of Justice report, Eric Holder signed off on, that the hands up, don't shoot narrative did not actually occur. So then my question is, nevertheless, you still write about it and still talk about it a lot, so it's clear to me that you think we learned something from Ferguson, even though those things didn't happen. What did we learn about policing and criminal justice from the Ferguson situation last year?
It was a really interesting moment because there were two DOJ reports, really, that came out about Ferguson. I think that they were technically separate, but certainly they were functionally separate. One talked about Michael Brown and the circumstances of his shooting, which are still murky, and to me, no clear conclusions can really be drawn from the evidence that we have. I think it was correct that there wasn't enough evidence to charge criminally the officer. Whether he ultimately did wrong or right, I don't have enough information to say to my satisfaction. The other half of the Ferguson report talked about the history of policing in Ferguson going back at least a couple of decades, and just really pervasive misconduct. Part of it was what people call policing for profit, where you're balancing the budget of the city on the backs of the poor by giving them ticket after ticket, and people, mm-hmm. you know, will go and miss a court date, and then the fine goes from $50 to $100, and soon they owe $700 because of a parking ticket, and they can't pay it off.
Yeah.
There were circumstances of police officers, in one case, rushed the car of a man who was just parked sitting there and pulled him out and were very aggressive. So reading that Ferguson report, mm-hmm. you could see why, when the Michael Brown shooting happened, people in the community, if it wasn't that, it would have been something else. There's going to be a straw that broke the camel's back, because there was no trust between the police department and the citizenry. And how could there be, given the experience that people had on a daily basis? Much of it, amazingly much of the stuff that was in the Ferguson report was totally invisible to most of the country. If you didn't live in perhaps St. Louis County and the area around there, I'd covered police abuses in New York, in Washington, D.C., two cities that I lived in, and most of all in California. And so, especially growing up in California at the time that I did, you know, the Rodney King case loomed large in everybody's minds in L.A. and police brutality in the LAPD, but there really wasn't the same policing for profit issue.
Yeah.
That was a new focus for me, reading the Ferguson report. And so I think if you look at Ferguson and Baltimore, the two places where they've had the most civic unrest, it's no coincidence that those are also the same places where you have tremendous police abuses. And you have other communities where you've had a little bit more representative police, less police misconduct over the years, and you'll have a shooting that is actually very, you know, it's on video that the police officer was in the wrong, and you won't have the same civic unrest. And that's because people feel more represented, less abused for less amounts of time. And so it's that other Ferguson report, I think, that was much more enlightening about the overall situation there.
Yeah. We're going to move to Q&A now, and we've got, once again, one microphone right over there, and I think there's a second. No, that's just the one microphone in the center. So people who've got questions for a journalist can start lining up. As people start walking towards the mic, I will say that actually that is what I heard talking to people on Monday night. People were going on endlessly about the ticketing situation, saying this has been happening for years. They phrased it just the way you did. If it wasn't the Michael Brown situation, something else was going to trigger this kind of unrest, because people were so upset by this feeling that they were relentlessly harassed, that the city was trying to balance its budget writing tickets. It was really troubling. But let's turn to audience questions right here, sir.
Thank you. I'm Benjamin F. Chavis, Jr. I'm president of the National Newspaper Publishers Association, representing the black press in America, the print press, that incidentally has not died, still much alive. In fact, I would say that the black press, the print press in America, is reviving, growing strong. We're the trusted press in our communities. But the question is about this conference. I think there's probably one issue where Republicans and Democrats agree, where liberals and conservatives agree, and that is the need for criminal justice reform. So my question to the panel is, what can be done to get the so-called mainstream media to focus more on the good that is happening in terms of the call for criminal justice reform?
Well, why don't we just do that one by one, starting with Conor? What do you think?
I've covered the Black Lives Matter movement a lot, and it's been, I think, widely embraced in the mainstream media. It's also very polarizing in some parts of the country. You've seen this debate about all lives matter versus Black Lives Matter, for example. One thing that I've tried to do in my writing is to point to part of that movement, the Campaign Zero move, the Campaign Zero, I don't know what they call it. It's a bunch of reforms that are a really thoughtful, well-done set of policy reforms. It seems to me a really good place that people who have disagreements about kind of larger theories about race in America or economic inequality, they can disagree about those issues and still say, okay, it would be great if after there's a police shooting, if the officer had to testify right away instead of having 2 days to confer with a police union and get the story straight with other officers. It would be great if there were body cameras that were available to the public or the press or someone who can review what happens in these situations. I really think that focusing on those reforms instead of politicized infighting among different groups about what the hashtag should be is the best way forward. And I try and do that as a member of the press. I don't think that you can ever stop the press from covering people yelling at one another. Mm-hmm. But we're also at a time when so many of these stories that come out in, you know, a story comes out in The Atlantic and a lot of people come to it because it's shared on Facebook, because it's shared on Twitter. Everyone in this room has a social network at this point and decides what stories they share. Mm-hmm. So certainly lobby editors talk to people, email reporters whose coverage you don't like and say, well, why don't you do it this way? Why don't you do it different? They do read. But also everyone at this point can drive media coverage in some sense by just sharing things that are elevating and good instead of things that are clickbait and enraging.
Sure. Scott, do you have any thoughts on the question?
Well, I do think that from my perspective, the mainstream press has kind of embraced reform for the most part. I mean, I think that, you know, all the justice reinvestment stuff gets a lot of good play wherever it goes. Right on Crime gets a lot of good play. I think that the debates around the Black Lives Matter have not been hostile from the mainstream media. They certainly have played out the debate over all lives versus Black lives, but they haven't, I think, been openly hostile. I think to me probably the main thing is just the barrier is this issue you talked about with just it's hard, we don't have very many experienced reporters on the criminal justice beats and often you kind of have to lead them to the story a little bit more because they just don't have the chops to jump on it themselves. But then there's a room full of advocates here to sort of lead them to water. So I think that, you know, we're in a pretty decent place from my perspective.
Reihan, what do you think?
I have a slightly different perspective on this. And this is an area in which I disagree with some of my colleagues too. But I guess I think that we sometimes have these overcorrections. So, you know, and you see people in the news media, they will move very sharply in one direction. There's an overcorrection because we have this new narrative. The new narrative is that the whole criminal justice system was just massively broken. This was a huge overreaction. Maybe it's because it was racist or whatever else. That's our new narrative. We're all settled around this, and now we're all in favor of criminal justice reform. And I think that there's another way to look at it, which is criminal justice reform, you know, what does that mean? That means different things in different contexts. There's so many different pieces to the system. And I would argue that one really big issue is that homicide clearance rates in the United States are extremely low. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean all that much if you're someone who doesn't know someone who's been murdered, or if you live in a community where a number of homicides is pretty small. But if you live in a community where there's a huge number of homicides, you yourself know someone who has been killed, and that murder was not cleared. You know, no one was ever held accountable for it. That saps trust in the system. That makes you less likely to want to cooperate, perhaps because, you know, you just don't believe the system works all that well. That's a dimension of this issue that I think tends to get neglected. Just the idea that actually the simple efficacy of our systems in terms of building trust, giving people reason to believe that actually if you are wronged, if you are the victim of violence, and by the way, there is a narrow group of people in our country that is just massively disproportionately victimized by crime, of course you're gonna, like, you know, you're talking about, you know, police being abusive, totally an issue. But partly it's an issue because, hey, people are being abusive using preventive policing tactics, and they're not even able to actually solve a crime. And I think that that other half of the puzzle is actually really, really important. So I think that, you know, in a way, a lot of the emphasis in criminal justice reform advocacy now is about let's make the system less punitive, et cetera, which I think, you know, has some value. But I think the other half of it about, well, why don't people trust the system? Why? Partly because it's not delivering for them. And I think that that's another important part of the conversation that I think isn't all that salient to reporters who feel pretty safe. That sense of victimization, particularly now that, you know, crime in certain communities is so much lower than it had been before, that doesn't mean that it's gone away.
Right. We have another question here.
Yeah, so the media covers and arguably affects elections a lot of times. And I come from a place where the chief prosecutor is elected and the chief public defender is not. So I'd like y'all's opinion on whether prosecutors and or public defenders should be elected, and how maybe the narrative can be changed to leading communities to whichever solution you agree with.
Scott, I want to direct that to you first, because I think you've written a bit about this at Grits.
Well, not too much, because we have elected prosecutors in Texas, and the chances of that changing anytime soon are so minuscule that I don't really spend too much time on it. I would not prefer elected prosecutors or elected judges if you make me Philosopher King, and I don't think that either me becoming Philosopher King or us stopping electing those folks is going to happen anytime soon. So,
don't even bother with it. Reihan, Conor, you guys have thoughts?
This slightly different perspective. So one big issue is that in state and local elections, people vote. If they're partisan elections, they vote pretty much the exact same way they vote at the national level, even though at the state and local level, the issues are very, very different.
Right.
And that's partly because, you know, party service heuristics as shortcuts. Yeah. You know, I know roughly what I'm going to get, even if you actually don't know what you're going to get in the case of a prosecutor. What's the difference between a Democratic prosecutor and a Republican prosecutor? I mean, maybe there's a slight difference in emphasis, but in a place like Texas, I imagine a lot of those Democratic prosecutors are going to be pretty aggressive and whatever else. I tend to think when you're thinking about prosecutors, I think a much bigger issue is whether or not they are called upon to balance trade-offs, to make trade-offs. So, you know, if I'm just becoming more and more punitive, but I'm not bearing any of the costs of being punitive, that seems like an issue. You know, if I'm elected, but I have to actually have to kind of balance these considerations, that's quite another thing than I'm elected and I don't have to balance these considerations. Or consider the fact that, you know, in most states in the country, at the local level, they are financing police, but long-term incarceration is financed at the state level. That's a mismatch. So let's say, you know, one strategy could be, well, if we have more investment in policing and more effective policing, well, that might reduce crime so we can incarcerate fewer people. Now, maybe that's true, maybe that's not, but that's one theory. Now, the thing is that, you know, but if I'm only bearing the cost for the policing, why would I pursue that strategy? So I think in a way, it's less about, you know, kind of the elections, although I think that, you know, doesn't seem like a great idea to me. It's more about whether or not those elected officials are actually bearing any responsibility for their decisions mm-hmm. and the costs they're imposing on other people.
Yeah.
I would just say, I don't have a strong opinion one way or the other about whether they should be elected or not. The place where I would like to see more political engagement is the decisions that police chiefs are making about what kind of policing are they going to do, and especially what kind of technology are they going to bring to bear. I've been writing about the NYPD and these colloquially called x-ray vans that they have, their mobile x-ray technology that they can bring around the city and look inside a parked vehicle, apparently look through the walls of certain buildings. It's unclear how they're using this. The technology does emit radiation. It's unclear if they're using it on a street with someone walking by. And these are all questions that they just won't give an answer to, and ProPublica has been engaged for 3 years in a lawsuit to try and get these answers and has prevailed, but it keeps getting appealed. To me, at a political philosophy level, whatever policing policy is, whatever technology we should have, it's a decision for the people to make through their elected representatives, whether that's a mayor, whether that's a city council. And if all of these decisions could be a political issue, however they come out, I think that that would be much better than unaccountable police chiefs or even people below the chief level making a decision about, wow, there's this really cool technology, we want it. Let's just start using it without telling anyone.
Yeah. Got another question?
Yes, my name is Vincent Gilbert. I'm the regional vice president of the Illinois Black Chamber of Commerce. This has really been fascinating, having true journalists. My question is, most people are familiar with the television show Mad Men and how they shaped perception and how then perception became reality. Can you talk about how perception is skewed by reality with the phrase that we see all the time, gang related?
Connor, you want to say something?
Gang related is one of those phrases that a watch commander will say all the time when you're the newspaper reporter calling them. You could call it lazy journalism, and sometimes it is. But I think more than laziness, it's just a function of a weird model of police reporting where you just listen to what the authorities say and then you print that thing. And then you have other reporters who are maybe doing enterprise stories about larger issues that come out once every 2 months or something. But you know, gang-related can mean so many different things. It's not, oftentimes it's not a useful thing to tell readers without any greater context. My thought on it is just that it's a function of newsrooms that have very little time to report things and go for stock phrases. It sounds like the kind of thing you'd hear on the local news too, where they have 30 seconds to tell some crime story. All that kind of crime coverage to me, I mean, it sells. That's why they have it on the local news every night. People watch it again and again, whether they think they like it or not, they keep going back to it. I don't think that it's particularly useful in getting a picture of what's actually happening in your city, how safe you are.
This is going to take us slightly over time, but let's take one more question, because we've got one more questioner at the microphone.
Right. I am Frances Brigham Johnson of American Catalyst. We are founding a new website for input by citizens, police departments, and articulate citizens all over the country. I'm here to ask your advice as to what kind of stories would be useful to receive from the audience and put into the website for use by those at the local level responsible for public safety, that is the mayors and the sheriffs who have to run and have to form a platform that they give to their constituents and articulate citizens for improvement of their public safety system.
Okay, well, let's give that to you, Scott, because you've been doing that kind of writing for many, many years now. What's good advice?
Well, again, I think we're in an era when we are flooded with information. There's all of us have more information at our fingertips than we can really possibly process. And so what I find that folks really want from, you know, my website certainly, isn't necessarily for me to tell them the news. They all subscribe to the newspaper too. It's to tell them what all this information means, to somehow piece it together and derive meaning from it. And often information is just swirling around us, and it's not always there at the moment we need it, the right piece of information. I mentioned earlier one of the things that Grits does is tries to catalog the piece of information that just flies past the screen one day when I know I'll need it 15 months later or maybe 3 years later, but I know down the line when we're debating this issue, I may need this. Well, it coming out today doesn't help, but me having it cataloged in a place where I can go back and get it will help at the moment when we do need it. And so to the extent that you can provide that sort of service on the issue areas that you're going to cover, other people will find value in that. So that would be my best suggestion.
Well, our panel is concluded. Please join me in giving a round of applause to our three journalists. The panel has concluded, but that doesn't mean that the night has concluded. We're going to have a dessert reception right outside of these doors. I hope everybody will mingle and talk about some of the things that they learned today. And tomorrow morning, we'll see you here at 8:45. Thank you.